Hello, everyone. This is Space Cafe Podcast, and I am Marcus.
Know that Marcus originally a Roman name, is Marco in Italian.
What can I say? Our guest today comes from the Eternal City and has decided to leave it to follow her passion. And of course, there's only one Eternal City, right?
I'm Roman.
For most Romans, such a step would be unthinkable. But Simonetta has good reasons. Simonetta di Pipo is the director of a United Nations office directly from a science fiction movie. There is no other possibility, and the coolness is unbeatable. And now she lives in Vienna, Austria. Not a bad address either. By the way, it's also where I live. Before we start our journey with Simonetta, a small note on our behalf. We would like to give you the opportunity to tell us who you would like to see or hear in the show, or what topics you are interested in. Let us know and we'll try our best to provide you with what you always wanted, the best and coolest stories from the space industry. So write us an email at podcast@spacewatch.global. We are looking forward to it. Back to our current episode. 3, 2, 1, go. So Simonetta, are you aware of the fact that you are living currently in one of the most, no, the most livable city in the world?
Aha, so the first time I heard about that was already a few years ago, which means that since I'm in town, I started to live here beginning of 2014. So I've been in the last few years in the, one of the best towns in the world, which is not bad.
What's your guess? How many times in a row has Vienna been awarded this?
I believe several times now. I don't remember exactly, but I heard that several times.
I can tell you 10 times it is.
Wow.
Now look at that. But it's a good place. It's a good place to live, even for an Italian.
Absolutely.
Right? Because who wants to leave Italy? How was that for you? Was it difficult?
Well, no. I mean, I left Italy in 2008 when I moved from the Italian Space Agency to the European Space Agency, becoming the director of human spaceflight. Then I went to Brussels. So Northern Europe. And then after 2 years in Brussels, I moved here, which is closer to Italy. But at that time in 2008, I decided to follow my inclination to try really to be supportive. So, yeah.
Simonetta, considering the title on your business card, the director of the United Nations Office for Outer Space, I mean, if I were in your shoes, I would permanently leave my business card on random tables just to show off. So how often do you do that?
Well, if you allow me to joke, in one of my past professional lives, just for a night, I became the director of the universe.
The universe.
It was a mistake. Yeah, which is not so bad as a title. Now, jokes apart, in reality, the Office for Outer Space Affairs at the United Nations is really quite an interesting place to live and work, because I feel that there is a purpose on what I'm doing. I feel privileged to be able to work in a field that I like so much. Despite the quite interesting title on my business card, I'm really rewarded from what I do. And so that's the reason why working 24/7, because I really work hard, that's true. But it's because working for me is a way of living, and I have so many friends all over the world, because I believe that each and every one working in the space community is really, it's the same spark of trying to bring humanity towards a better future. And that's really rewarding. Mm-hmm.
So in order to do a quick sketch of what the UNOSA, I think that's the proper pronunciation, is all about. So would it be fair to say that people or humanity have discovered a new amusement park that is space? And now everyone wants to go there.
And of course, that brings problems, and it's not easy. It needs rules. Would that sort of encompass what the UNOSA is all about?
Yes, but it's a little bit, it's something more, because one of the main goals we have is really to bring the benefits of space to humankind. Which sounds quite generic, but it's true. What we are trying to say is that with this statement, is that in reality, space is already, at least for us, permeating our, really, it's in every minute of our life. And so we are already, at least in the developed countries, we are already living in a space-based society, which is a knowledge-based society, but is in reality a space-based society. Because the number of satellites each of us is using every single day is very high.
And how far does that go beyond like the obvious Google Maps and stuff like that? So do you have other examples where we employ, and of course television, the use of satellites?
Yeah, for example, when you go to the ATM to get your cash, this is linked to an atomic clock, and then it's linked to a constellation of satellites. Mm. So in order to synchronize the time, and this is another example. Or for example, if you use the Wi-Fi on the plane, which is a problem for me, because being on a flight from here to New York, for example, was what I was liking really a lot, because it was without connections, at least for a few hours. Mm. Now you have connections everywhere, also the plane, on the trains, on boats, etc. So you are really connected when it was not possible. And then if you are, another example, if you are in a situation where you have a disaster, for example, a flood or a landslide or things like that, satellite images can really help a lot, and can help also in agriculture, for example, in mapping water reservoirs, or in doing biodiversity research studies, or a lot of different things. And also what is extremely important, in my opinion, is that it's a way for a country, in particular a developing and emerging country, to, on one side, increase the services for their citizens so they can use space-based data and infrastructures developed by others, put in orbit by others, but most of them have an open and free data access, for example, for the global navigation satellite system, mm-hmm. or even sometimes Earth observation constellations. So services and applications can be applied, that can be developed in those countries. And that's usually the entry level. But then they do need to have communication satellites, etc. So what we do is really to bring training, capacity building, helping these countries to get more and more acquainted with space activities, and so improve the quality of life of their citizens.
So one could say that space is, or has become, a part of Earth already, because we're just like onion skins. We're extending our reach, but not only for exploration reasons, but also for reasons that make or produce benefit for our earthly lives. So we're just extending our sphere of influence. Would that be right?
Yes, all this satellite, telecommunication, earth observation, navigation and geolocalization, all these satellites, meteorology, don't forget that, are extremely important for the day-by-day life, and so protecting and improving the conditions of living on Earth. At the same time, we have also to consider that we have, for example, the International Space Station, which is this big lab in orbit developed by 15 countries with a lot of experiments from other countries, where you can really create new materials. There is, for example, this made in space trend of really making, I mean, products in space,
like,
and also,
like,
for example, the composition of a pill is more clean than if you do it on Earth, for example. This is a study that has been done a long time ago. The cameras that we now use on our smartphones were developed for space missions. Now, someone can say, okay, sooner or later, that the same kind of technology would have been developed for Earth-related applications. And it's probably true. Eh? Mm-hmm. There are few technologies that probably would have been developed in any case. But the fact that you need really to match quite important challenges or difficult challenges, then this stimulates
driver.
Also the public spending. Mm-hmm. Absolutely, and brings a lot of innovation in society.
Manetta, what's currently the most fascinating space project that you see on the horizon?
The best project, we have a lot of very good projects. One that I like a lot is this Access to Space for All. It started just a few years ago. We have space agencies, governments, we have research centers, we have private companies helping us with a very good social corporate responsibility, where they support the Office for Outer Space Affairs with a sort of an investment from their side to help us bring in more and more teams, more and more countries to the space family. And for example, we have been able with the KipoCube project, which is a project that we developed with Japan, the JAXA, the Japanese Space Exploration Agency, we have been able to support Kenya 2 years ago and now Guatemala this year to launch their first satellite ever. And we continue, we have selected some other countries which will do the same. We have experiments on board the Chinese space station. We have experiments with the private sector. So we are really expanding the opportunities for everyone in the world to access space. And this is a very good example of what we call triangular cooperation, mm-hmm. where we have UN at the center, developed countries, developed stakeholders helping us, and then developing countries benefiting from that.
It's very interesting because, I mean, like the obvious spacefaring nations, those who started everything, they now have most access to the hardware because they developed the hardware. But now you can bring in new ideas that could play with that already established hardware. Like, that's a pretty fascinating approach also, I could imagine.
Absolutely. And also the fact is that I see a strong interest from developed countries and stakeholders to really help. And this is what will bring us to what I call the stakeholder space economy. So a space economy where also the private sector is here helping the public sector to support countries and teams for sustainable development.
How does that work? Does your telephone ring on a regular basis? How does that work?
Oh, this is one side. Yeah, this sometimes happens. But what we do, we launched what we call the World Space Forum, was before the high-level forum that became last year with the first edition in Vienna, by the way, the World Space Forum. The idea is really to bring all the potential stakeholders together to expand the interest of user communities. So not necessarily user communities which are really not even knowing that they don't even know that space can be very helpful for what they need to do. And last but not least, we try really to connect the dots. For example, we had the lockdown in Vienna starting mid-March, more or less. And immediately after, I created a task force called Space for Health, and with the main goal of understanding how space could help for the COVID-19 pandemic situation, but in particular, how this could help, how space can help in the post-COVID-19 phase. So mainly what we call the Build Back Better, and trying to use space technologies and applications to help people to better cope with this unfortunate situation.
This is a fascinating project. So I could imagine that there is no country on earth who wouldn't want to be part. So is everyone aboard, or who does not want to be on board of the UNOSA in the first place?
Well, when I took up duty in the beginning of 2014, we have the Committee on the Peaceful Uses of Outer Space, which is made by member states. At that time, it was made by 76 member states. Now we are 95. Unfortunately, 2020 has been quite standby due to the mm-hmm. COVID-19. But we have already other countries in the pipeline. When I arrived, they said, I want 100 member states by 2020. Only COVID-19 stopped us because we reached 95 last year. And so we have to wait for next year. So that's the reason why we have to postpone the famous goal of 100. When it was possible to travel, I was doing 2 or 3 new members per year, which is quite already mm-hmm. heavy. Visiting them, meeting ministers, trying to explain which is the advantage of being part of the family, of having a responsible behavior, of really joining our activities to grow and to be able to support their citizens. Mm.
And also we have situations in which I remember a couple of times was visiting various areas of the globe. And I was saying, okay, tell us what you need. We will try to find a space-based solution for you. Or if we don't have it, we have all the connections to try to find it. Mm-hmm. And then they were looking at me and saying, because space can help us on what? And then I was saying, okay, you probably have an issue with sea level rise. So probably you have an issue on agriculture, or you want to map your towns, or you want to study migration or illegal fishing. And they were looking at me with big eyes saying, really? Mm. And so then we started to make some basic training where we were explaining which were the possibilities. And then we started some projects, for example, one in the Pacific Island States with the support of New Zealand. And we went there, we visited them, all the Pacific Island States. They have a huge problem, again, with sea level rise. But they didn't know that we can help them with observation images. And just an example to say that it's a question really of presenting what we can offer, listening to what they need, and then going back again and presenting what we can do for them in a customized manner. Mm-hmm. So it's really fascinating. Mm-hmm.
Does UNOSA actually have some sort of jurisdiction when it comes to rules and regulations? For example, when it comes to space traffic management.
Space traffic management is quite a trendy topic, I have to say, quite interesting. And indeed, it's discussed under the umbrella of the Committee on the Peaceful Uses of Outer Space. We as the executive, so as the Office for Outer Space Affairs, we really make some studies internal. We keep us always updated. We discuss with member states because at the very end, our main role is really to support member states on what mm-hmm. they want to mm-hmm. do. I have to underline the fact that we are the only one in the world to maintain the register of the objects launched into outer space based on the registration convention is something that we do on behalf of the Secretary General. So we discharge this responsibility on behalf of the Secretary General. It's the only treaty-based tool in the world. It's a sort of a transparency tool where everyone is notifying us that they launched their satellites. And we put all this information on our website. So whatever you want to do on any kind of satellite which has been launched in space since 1957, you can find it on our website.
Very interesting.
And it's extremely fascinating.
I'm typing as we speak. Where do I need to go? So it's on the UNOSA site, right?
UNOSA.org.
Very interesting. Good. I'll look into that once we're done. Very interesting. So does that also include the nefarious activities? Do you think you have all the secret missions also on record?
Okay. Member states notify us about all the objects launched. Mm, mm-hmm. Not necessarily specifying what they do. However, for various reasons, we don't have the full coverage of all the satellites launched since the very beginning. But the reason is, the very beginning of the space era, the reason is that, first of all, there is a mismatch between the number of objects launched into outer space per year and the number of objects registered for two reasons. The first one is that we register also non-functional objects, mm-hmm. a booster, for example. And there are countries which notify us even when they have a re-entry. So, for example, a booster re-enters the atmosphere. It's found in a desert, whatever. So there are a few countries which register also this kind of objects. And that's the first reason why there is a difference. The second reason why there is a difference, a mismatch, is because in particular the countries which launch a lot of satellites, they don't notify every time they launch. So they put a batch of satellites all together and then they send us the notification. So I don't know, the last 3 months, the last 6 months, they put all together this set of information and they send the set of information to us. On average, we cover more or less everything. but there is a bit of mismatch on a short term.
Is there a fine on your end for not reporting? So how much money do you charge?
No, we don't have anything like that. But I have to say that countries, in particular the ones which launch a lot of satellites, stick very well with their commitments. But there are countries which are not yet at the point to having a national legislation or a national authority which is able then to certify, to notify to us the information. And so, for example, when we helped Kenya to launch the first satellite, we also imposed, in a way, that they had to register the satellite because you cannot have a satellite launched under the auspices of the UN without registering. I mean, it would have been not proper. So they had to create, they created the National Space Agency, and then they created the National Space Law, so they've been able to register. So you see, even if it was one unit CubeSat, so a CubeSat of 10 centimeters, did a lot of things, but still it's not a huge stuff. Still, this triggered a sort of a domino positive effect. And if we do this with all the other players which entered the system through us or thanks to us, in reality, we also support the responsible behavior of these new players since the very beginning. So we support, in a way, the long-term sustainability of outer space activities. Okay, you could say, is a drop in the ocean? Yes or no?
So when it comes to space activity, you have the usual suspects on the stage, the usual names on the stage. So I'd be interested to hear from you who, in your opinion, are the most promising new names for the future on the horizon. So who's a promising and interesting spacefaring nation, and for what reason?
There are a few interesting examples that we have been dealing with in the recent past. One wonderful example, I would say, is New Zealand. Just an example. New Zealand became a member of the committee just a few years ago. They created the space agency because they really wanted also to support launches from their country. And so they needed the legislation, so they created also the law. And then they started to become even more and more supportive of the activities of the office. And so together with they really supported us with some funds to focus on the needs of the Pacific Island states. Mm-hmm. So they supported, they created all the infrastructure they needed, etc. Quite a wonderful example of a very responsible new player and supporter. And I have to say that I am experiencing in the last 1 year, 1 year and a half, we started to experience new projects. For example, this project called Space Law for New Space Actors. Mm-hmm. Again, you are promoting responsible behavior, where we have countries which have been in the Committee for the Peaceful Uses of Outer Space since ages. And now they are starting to support us also with funds on these specific projects because we probably are really targeting needs that were there and that were not captured before. Mm-hmm. So this is also interesting because you see a common interest between member states, the office, and developing countries, et cetera, which is, as I said before, fascinating.
The more traffic is being produced when it comes to space activity, the more issues, of course, one gets when it comes to traffic management, but also when it comes to space debris. So my question would be, how much space at the moment is left at all for future missions? How crowded, how populated is it already by problematic space debris?
Well, this is one of the topics which has been discussed really at length, I would say, under the umbrella of the committee and also in our activities. What we do, we really try to increase awareness of the situation and try on one side to mitigate for the future. But at the same time, there is also a need sooner or later to see how we can clean the orbits. And this will require certain decisions on a global scale.
I heard that the orbits cannot be cleaned anymore. Is that because there's too much debris up there?
There are solutions under study. most countries, the most developed countries, have already some projects in the pipeline with different technical solutions to clean space. It's also a political discussion that has to be done, because also in that case, we need the rules of the road. And we have already the guidelines, the long-term sustainability guidelines, and also we have the space debris mitigation guidelines, which were approved a long time ago. It's true that the biggest countries are really following these rules, but it's also true that more and more we go for small satellites and things like that. And if, for example, you want to do a controlled reentry maneuver, then you need the bigger satellite, more fuel on board, a certain number of, let's say, an ability to really maneuver in orbit, etc. There is a need, both from a technical standpoint, but mainly from the regulatory standpoint, to continue discussing. And this is, as I said, a topic that is discussed in the past and also right now at length in COPUS and two subcommittees. But I see an increasing interest from the new players to really understand what they can do in order to support space as a global common. We must really maintain space for future generations. And so there are a lot of things to be done, but I see a converging interest in member states to do.
Very interesting. It's like that the young ones understand what is at stake and that we need to do something about it.
Well, we have a project called Space for Youth, where every year, in agreement with the Space Generation Advisory Council, we issue a sort of a call, an announcement, where we, the first time we asked the youngest in the world to send us proposals linked, I mean, for projects or ideas or papers. I am strongly in favor of strong diversity in terms of gender, in terms of geography, in terms of age, because you need both the experience of, yeah, senior experts, but you need also the creativity and new ideas, a new way of looking at the world that comes from the youth. And so if we combine all the elements, again, the same approach, the more we listen, the more we can find the best possible solution for the future.
I heard that the most favorable profession amongst young children is not astronaut anymore. It has become influencer. How can you help turn that development back again? What can be done here?
That's a good question. It is never so easy, but I can try to answer with an example. A few years ago, I attended the International Astronautical Congress. I believe it was in Mexico. And Elon Musk, the owner of SpaceX, he never attends this kind of conferences, but at that time, he was supposed to present his Mars mission, Starship and everything. It was 3 years ago, 4 years ago. Okay, there was a huge exhibition area and there was a huge, let's say, meeting room, and it was hosting thousands of people. So it was really a huge place. And so the evening before I was leaving the place, the evening before Elon Musk was supposed to speak, and I was leaving the place at 7 p.m. and I found long queues of very young people already in the building with their sleeping bags, because they wanted to have the possibility to enter the meeting room the morning after when Elon Musk was supposed to arrive and speak. And so they started to queue the night before. Now, what it means? It means that if you have an inspiring topic, if it's something that really stimulates, it's inspirational, thinking about going on another planet, this can bring the attention back to science. And my point is that also, it's strange to say, but it's also what the youngest in the famous Fridays of Greta Thunberg, etc., she is always saying the same, let's bring science at the center. Let's bring science at the center is always what I'm trying to say. It also helps against fake news. It helps people to understand that the Earth is not flat. I'm always discussing this. It's 30 years that I'm trying to find a way, and we succeed from time to time, find a way really to bring people at the table, the youngest. And my best moment was a few years ago when a young kid came to me and said, I saw you on YouTube. I want to become like you.
Wow.
Now, I said, oh my God, are you sure you're talking about, I mean, about me? But yeah, and it's something that I believe we have to get closer to people, speak with simple words, but at the same time show how fascinating is working in this field and how important it is to have science at the center.
You know what? I have two young daughters aged 9 and 11, and whenever Elon shoots one of his rockets into orbit, I have them sit right next to me and watch what's going on. And they totally share that fascination, because not only can they sense what I feel as their father and that I have goosebumps all over the place, but I think they feel the fascination. And the cool thing is, and this is something completely new for me as a young father, to see that there's no difference, no gender difference. So it does not matter at all when a rocket launches, if you're a boy or a girl, goosebumps are guaranteed.
And I can tell you that I probably started my space career when I was 10 years old and was the first humans landing on the moon. Mm-hmm. And probably I was not aware that, but I was so fascinated. And I attended so many shuttle launches and other launches all over the world in my career. And every time after 35 years that I do so, it's still the same. And so the passion, the fact that really you want to be there, you want to follow this rocket going up in the sky and showing the abilities and the ingenuity of humanity is fascinating. I know that I'm using this term a lot, but that's my life.
Beautiful. So I think this question, next question, it's perfectly here, because what drives you, Simonetta, personally? What's your personal mission? Because like you had so many different steps towards becoming where you are right now. So you can have stopped at ESA, you could have stopped in different places, in Brussels.
Yeah.
What drives you? What's your personal mission? Why do you do what you do?
First of all, since when I was young, I wanted to have a job which allows me to learn every single day. So I cannot stop learning. That's a problem I have. I don't know what to say. So I need to learn. And so my brain really wants to do always something new. And what is important is that I don't care particularly about the power, quote unquote, that is linked to the place. What I like is the fact that in certain positions, I can help the others. I can do something for the others. Because as I said, I feel privileged in being able to do what I liked, and I continue to do what I like, which means being one of the main players in the space business. And this is fascinating, because I know that where I go, I can bring added value. I can bring other people in the same, let's say, on the same boat, and we all together do something which is rewarding per se. So it's not a question of salary. It's not a question of place where you live. It's really being part of the progress of humanity. That's what motivates me.
Beautiful. Thank you for your openness. Speaking of openness, Simonetta, do you like science fiction?
I have to tell you, not particularly. I like the science fiction that is very close to science.
Good. Did you get to watch Salvation on Netflix?
I did.
Good. For those who do not know what we're talking about, it's about the imminent arrival of an asteroid headed towards Earth, threatening to destroy life on Earth, and the countermeasures that humans want to undertake to prevent that from happening. Of course, the Americans take those countermeasures in their hands, and the rest of the world watches what the Americans can do to be again the saviors of Earth. So now, Simonetta, I'm so glad to have you on this show right now, because now I can ask you firsthand, If that happened, if everything that's being portrayed in Salvation, that an asteroid is headed towards Earth, and we have, I don't know, 3 months left, would it be possible that a nation like the Americans could take everything in their hands, or would there be a global debate about consequences?
Wonderful question, because among other things that we do, we support a group of member states and space agencies with two groups of member states which are dealing exactly with these topics and studying together possible solutions in case an asteroid is on the wrong trajectory against the Earth. Or even we are working to see which kind of civil protection measures we could put in place. And these two groups are meeting regularly. We serve as the executive secretariat, but we are also supporting these groups with the expertise, with the experience we have with the SPIDER program. The SPIDER program is a program which has been approved by the General Assembly in 2006, and is a program that through which we provide space-based data and services to all member states in need in case of a disaster, mm-hmm. and in particular in the emergency response phase. And so we have 25 centers, nationally managed, originally managed. Mm-hmm. And so we have agreements with these 25 centers, usually are either research centers or mainly civil protection entities. So we have already this network all over the globe, and we are now offering to this group dealing with planetary defense against asteroids, we are offering this network because we can really disseminate information in every corner of the world in just a click, thanks to mm-hmm. this network. Mm-hmm. And so we are now seeing in which manner we can protect the Earth and eventually prepare for that. The best would be to be able to detect a potential dangerous asteroid soon enough that we have collectively the possibility on a global scale to put together a mission, all the main space agencies, to counteract this possibility. So it's done in international cooperation as whatever we do.
Good to hear. Good to hear. Thank you. Simonetta, we're coming surely but gradually to the end of our beautiful show, but a couple more minutes for two more questions.
Yeah.
What are the most interesting space projects on the global horizon? So, of course, we have Artemis in 2024. Americans want to go back to the moon. Then we have a bunch of chit-chat about Mars, about bringing humans to Mars. Is that realistic in your point of view, in your opinion? And are there other fascinating projects you might have an advantage of already knowing about and could be able to share?
As I said, there are interesting scientific missions exploring planets or other celestial bodies. One quite interesting project, it's an American one, and is the James Webb Telescope, which is the brother, the follower of Hubble, which gave us a lot of information on at least on our, on our surroundings, far away, but still. Then I would say that for sure Artemis is an interesting project. The model is quite similar. It's a little bit different, but quite similar to the model that they use for the International Space Station, which has been fascinating until now and will continue to do so. And then all the activities on a private basis or going to Mars or going to asteroids or dealing with space resources and things like that. When you have a technology which is mature enough, then the entire system moves to something more demanding, more mm-hmm. challenging. Mm-hmm. And I believe this is the right moment now to, again, pull together the efforts for something done in international cooperation. Is a back to the moon for the United States, but is for the first time humanity potentially going together on another body of the solar mm. system, which will be the first time in history mm-hmm. ever.
Where are the moon villages we've been promised for so many decades? you see any of them in the future?
I am always of the idea that this cannot be done, whatever you do on another object of the solar system. Yes, a single mission to explore, it's fine. You want to show that you can go with the rover on Mars or on the moon, that's fine. But if you want to develop something more substantive and a more stable presence also of humans, then it cannot be done by a single country. Mm. So the idea of a moon village in technical terms means that you have an open architecture, but the architecture must be there because, yes, you need in any case a certain number of infrastructures. You need power. You need a launching pad, and probably even more than one, etc. You need crew quarters, and you can have several crew quarters from different countries. So what you need is really to have an architecture which is established and agreed by everyone who wants to participate, and then each country can contribute in line with the requirements, the funding they have, the needs they have, what they want to do, which kind of technologies they want to develop. So calling it a moon village is a way to express all of this in with simple words. But Artemis, at the very end, could be the first step of an open architecture. So in a way, of a moon village.
Beautiful. Wonderful. We have a fun tradition towards the end of our show. Mm-hmm. And it's a tradition everyone gets is being confronted with who is part of this show. And we call it Space Espresso. Because, of course, Vienna, and this is a Space Cafe podcast. An espresso is a quick story off the top of your head about whatever comes to your mind and you would like to share about science or space travel or space in general. Is there anything you would like to share?
Well, I just finished to watch on Netflix Challenger. Not because, I mean, it's quite well done from a technical perspective, but there is a moment in the shuttle sequence that I always like a lot. And it's not when the speaker says the shuttle cleared the tower or has cleared the tower. No, the most interesting, there are two moments that I liked a lot. One, he says Roger roll, which is the moment in which the shuttle changed inclination. And the other moment is this main engine cut off. The main engine cutoff is the moment in which you know that the shuttle is going and it's safe. So it's absolutely fascinating the way in which, as I said, I watched so many shuttle flights, and the sound and the power of human ingenuity is absolutely great. And I found that again in this, it's just four episodes. And I use the Challenger and the Columbia tragedies very often when I teach in business schools, because it's a way you learn what you don't have to do when you manage a team or when you have a big project. And the problem at the very end, technically, were different, but from a management standpoint, were the same. But Roger roll, main engine cutoff. These are my espressos.
Wonderful. Thank you so much, Simonetta. That was really inspiring. Thanks for taking the time.
My pleasure. Thank you so much. Bye-bye, ciao.
Thank you all for being with us today. It is unbelievable how time flies. We are working on Space Cafe episode 16, and you know what? It's becoming ever more fun. By the way, t-shirts. Check out our Spacewatch merchandise right over at spacewatch.global. There you can also sign up for the Spacewatch Global newsletter. I look forward to next time. Stay tuned. And if you have any time and motivation, leave us a 5-star rating. You know, that's the currency of the internet and helps keep this show as visible as possible. Thank you. Take care and see you soon.